you very much. Right, so far so good. Next stop for me is a beachside hospital ward where a scene is being shot for a very glamorous television series. The story is that the star has been injured and so has a colleague of his, and the star is about to visit him in his hospital bed, I think. Come on.
Everybody hold the talk, thank you. Quietly.
Gentlemen, I have permission to interrupt this moving moment.
What the hell is that?
I've always wanted to be part of the Baywatch scene, and the only way I could swing it was to get on a plane and fly from England with a book that says, David Hasselhoff, This Is Your Life. Yay! Don't open it yet.
What is this?
It's true. We have a studio just a few strokes away from here, full of people that you know and love, and a story to tell.
What?
We'll tell the story, so you've done your work for the day, in fact.
Well, yeah. Thank you.
Right.
That's it? It's a short show.
Walk this way, sir.
Okay.
Okay, you coming? You going?
Coming with you?
Yes. Thank you.
The way I'm dressed for you.
Welcome here, as you've seen, from the whole Hasselhoff family. Baywatch, as you may know, is seen in over 70 countries, and it's certainly one of Hollywood's most popular exports to Britain. The Californian sun shines in our gloomy winter evenings like this.
Good
choice.
What time is Hobie
coming home? Hobie is spending the night at a friend's house.
Oh, I should have known.
Unbelievable. Well, that was, the last bit was a perfectly legitimate clinch, of course, because the character there was played by your wife, actress Pamela Bach.
You got me so good. Oh. I had no idea. Oh. I guess we sit here?
Yeah.
I don't know.
And Pamela's not alone. More of your Baywatch team are here. Pamela Anderson, Alexandra Paul, and Jeremy Jackson. Is there room on this show for an elderly Englishman? I think I'd enjoy this. Pamela, I know you've been in several episodes of Baywatch. What is it like working with your husband in this?
God, it's so hard to answer a question after him being so surprised. I've been tight-lipped for so long, and it's like I have so much to ask him. What is it like performing opposite him? It's interesting. It's, it's a lot of fun. There you go. But when you know somebody so well, as a performer, you usually have this gray area that you can play with because the other person doesn't know you, everything about you. But he does. So he'll say, you normally wouldn't act like that. And it's like, well, that's a character. That's not me. So it's very interesting. We have fun. Spent a lot of time together.
Didn't he hold your passport back on one important occasion?
Yes, he did. We were in London, and we had been dating for about 5 months. And
don't tell the true story.
He sent me down. Yeah, I'm thinking about this one. He sent me down and hid my passport and my plane ticket to, I guess, confess his love and say, let's make a go for it.
Well, these days, of course, there are a couple of new names on that passport. Taylor, who is 3, and 1-year-old Haley.
Good.
Bye.
Oh, wow.
This is your life, Daddy. This is your life.
Oh. Oh, that's so sweet. Oh, my God.
I did that.
Well, David Michael Hasselhoff, this is your life, and here's you just a few weeks ago practicing a fast crawl. You were born on July the 17th, 1952, in Baltimore, Maryland, second child and only son of Joe and Dolores. Joe, your job in sales meant that you and the family moved to Jacksonville in Florida, and that's where young David first showed an interest in directing.
Yeah, we had a shaggy dog named Lassie, and nobody can control Lassie. So they asked us to put Lassie in a commercial where she had to jump in and out of the car. But we couldn't control her. So we got David to do it, because he's the only one she paid attention to. So it was a great success, except, you know, we didn't know where David was. He's in the back of the car, and Lassie was on top of him. But anyway, it worked out real good. He got $50, which he never gave me, incidentally. And he came home and he said, and I want to be an actor. So that's how it started.
Not always with animals.
Yeah.
You're 10 when you get your first chance to go on stage at the Little Theater Jacksonville. Rumpelstiltskin was the show, and you played the major domo. Dolores, was he thrilled about that?
He did great, but all the kids teased him about it, so he said he wasn't going to do it anymore.
Because of the makeup.
That's true.
Gave you a tough time, did they?
Mm.
Well, you take up the guitar when the family moves again, this time to Atlanta, Georgia. It was the start of a lifelong enthusiasm for music and song and laid the foundations for a second career David Hasselhoff pop star. Your album, Looking for Freedom, was number one in Germany when the Berlin Wall came down in 1989. You performed it in front of 500,000 people. A friend shot this home movie. I'm sure you won't forget that in a hurry. That was an extraordinary scene.
No, it's probably the most amazing experience of my life. And I was also very cold that evening because it was very strange because I was 2 below 0 and I sang. And the next day, I was actually in the water in Malibu, under the Malibu Pier, doing Baywatch, going, you're never going to believe what happened. It was awesome.
Yeah. Well, going back a few years, in those guitar-plucking school days in Atlanta, not only was your musical talent growing, you were. At the age of 17, you were already 6'4".
Yes, and you were the tallest boy on the school basketball team.
Your old basketball coach, Jerry Wilcox.
Jerry Wilcox? Ah! Oh, my God. Yes, I had white man's disease. I could not jump. I still can't jump.
I would have thought he'd be a great asset.
Oh, no. David
no.
was so big when he was young. We thought he'd be a fantastic player. But I'm here to tell you, he wasn't. He wasn't lousy, but he wasn't very good. Now, the first time we had a game, we put him in. He took the defensive rebound. He went up for the basket. It was the wrong basket. 5 times he shot at the wrong basket. Never made it. We convinced him his was down there someplace. Anyway, you were such a great kid, and maybe not a good basketball player, but a great kid. Never make the Basketball Hall of Fame, but you make fame on your own.
Unbelievable that you're here.
Thank you.
Jerry Wilcox. Unbelievable. Thank you. Wow. I gotta keep from getting emotional here. It's ridiculous.
Well, your story continues. You were 19 and on your way here to Los Angeles to study drama.
And we studied very, very hard at having a good time.
Oh, your God. Best pal and roommate back in 1970, David Stafford.
FF21!
Here you go.
Oh. Congratulations, man.
So, David, you weren't too serious as students.
Not with Dave's sense of humor and sense of fun, shall we say. Of course, we were more interested in chasing cheerleaders, but CalArts didn't have any cheerleaders.
That's right.
Just hippies and freaks and weirdos. And, well, they wanted to make partying an art form, and we, of course, joined their effort. And
but we got a motorcycle. Remember that? We got a motorcycle. That's right.
And he was my best man at my wedding last year.
Yeah,
I appreciate
that. Proud to be there. Thanks for coming. My God, it's unreal.
Thank you, Dave.
Thank you.
You're just 21 when you leave the college, and your first role was where I started tonight at Marina Del Rey. You were a waiter at a restaurant there. One of the customers was an important agent, and yes, just like in the movies, she takes you on. You get a part in an episode of TV's Police Story. You remember what it was?
Yeah, it was the doorman. It was like the valet. It was at the smokehouse in Burbank.
And Jean, your mother told the whole town of Sominok at that time in Illinois that David was on TV that night.
The whole town of Sominok was 1,100 people, and everybody was tuned in to watch this show. And just as David's part was coming on, it was preempted. Mayor Daley had won the election. We missed his 22nd part. And the whole town called us up on the phone, and Lisa went to sleep, cried herself to sleep that night. She was only 6 years old and had been given permission to stay up and watch David. And he wasn't on, and so she cried herself to sleep that night.
But in 1975, David, you really do get on TV and stay with the show for 6 years. You were Dr. Snapper Foster in one of America's longest-running daytime dramas, The Young and the Restless. Now let's reunite you tonight with three of the stars of that top American show and good friends of yours, Bob Colbert, Jamie Lynn Bauer, and the show's leading lady for 20 years, Jean Cooper.
Daddy-o.
Jamie.
Oh. Ooh. Mr. Brooks,
I will not buy her furniture.
Oh, you guys.
More reminiscing later.
I want to say one thing about Jeannie Cooper. Jeannie Cooper took me under her wing when I replaced William Gray Espy, who was the number one star in daytime, and I did not know my you-know-what from third base. And she took me to her house, and she gave me personal acting lessons. And with her, I overcame my fear and learned to believe in myself. And because of her, I went on to a few good things. But thank you, Jeannie. I always wanted to say it. Yeah. I'm good, sir. Thank you for coming. Bobby.
Well, after 6 years, you're aware of time passing by and you're understandably restless, but you're invited to audition for a new show in which the co-star is to be a car, a talking car. That must have been a very strange screen test.
Actually, it was a lot easier working with a car than some actors.
I was a nervous wreck, but I'd seen Brandon Tartikoff on an airplane before, and when the script came, I called my father, and I said, Dad, I've got the greatest script in the world. It's about a talking car. He thought I was completely out of my mind. And I said, no, this is it. But I was a nervous wreck for the screen test. But I went back after the first test, which I completely blew. And I said, you are the Knight Rider. You are Michael Knight. You are the Knight Rider. And completely made myself so scared that I went in and I was okay.
Did it.
And I got it.
The show, of course, was Knight Rider and became a huge hit in 82 countries. And Kit would like a few words with you now.
Hi, David. Remember me? Your pal, your buddy, your sidekick, your compadre, your friend? I can go on and on. However, I won't. I know this time is just for you. Have a great night on This Is Your Life. I'll sink a few extra gallons of gasoline to your health and happiness. Take care now. Oh, and Michael, thanks for your chance to talk to my old buddy, David. Congratulations.
Cars don't age. That's not true.
That's true. My car's Japanese. I can't understand a word it says. Anyway, in your four-year spin in Knight Rider, you also had some long-running human co-stars. And here tonight, Edward Mulhare, Peter Paris, and Patricia McPherson.
Edward!
God, you guys. Queen! The first time we've been together since 86. Yeah.
Edward, you, of course, played his boss.
Yes, I played Dylan.
Yes. Happy days?
Yes, it was great fun. As a matter of fact, it was one of the highlights of my professional life.
It's like Baywatch, you know, you form an alliance and a family with people and seeing, and something that lasts forever.
Well, we'll have a little celebration after this so you can talk about the old days. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay, how's Annie?
Well, Knight Rider was garaged for the last time in 1986, and for you, the road ahead looked uncertain. New acting roles were hard to find, so you turned again to music, and you went on the road with a rock band.
Yes.
And you went to Europe quite a lot. What did you call the group?
It was called David Hasselhoff and the Knight Rockers.
Yes. That took you to Europe, of course.
Yeah, we took the kit car to Europe, and now it's turned into forming in records and four platinum albums, and we're coming to the UK with our music, and I've got some really good producers in America, Bruce Swedeen and Renee Moore, who work with Michael Jackson. So it all, you know, it never give up, never give up.
Well, indeed, since then you have recorded four albums, Going Gold and Platinum with Everybody Sunshine, and here's your latest, If Only I Could Say Goodbye. Because when you were number one in Germany, you beat Madonna. I wonder how she felt about that.
I don't know. Why don't we call her and ask her?
It didn't surprise a friend of yours, of course, who knew you could do it. He'd been at the top himself long enough. He'd like a word here. Lou Rawls.
Oh, wow.
Hey, David. It's Lou here, buddy. Listen, man, I enjoyed doing Baywatch with you, but I tell you what, when we went to Vegas, you know, why did you disappear, man? I was trying to get you a gig in Vegas, man. You know, you got up there and you sang one song, and then you disappeared. I know what happened, though. The casino called you. Yeah, uh-huh. You know, the sevens and, you know, the 21s and stuff. I understand that. But that's cool, man. Hey, hang tight, buddy. Congratulations and have a good time. Listen, come on back so we can hang out some more, you know? Baywatch was cool in the game. Yeah, buddy.
All right, man. That's sweet, huh? New baby.
You'll never find.
Well, a big opportunity to get back in the acting game comes in 1989 in a television movie called Panic at Malibu Pier. Of course, it became Baywatch.
Oh, you ever think about giving all this up for something drier and more lucrative? Yeah, like what? Firm gave me a choice. Lawyer, lifeguard. Does that mean you'd quit Baywatch? Well, still have our early morning workouts together. You'd lose your locker. Take away my locker? Absolutely. Well, how many former lifeguards have got lockers at headquarters?
And your original co-star and good friend recalls those first days, Parker Stevenson.
I'm sorry I can't be there tonight. I wish I was there with you to celebrate tonight. As you can see, I've moved my lifeguarding skills on to Melrose Place. It really is a pool. I just sit here and wait for people in case someone falls in. This is about as close to the beach as I get these days. But I miss you. I miss your company. I miss the good times we had. You're what people don't know about you is you're one of the funniest people I've ever met. Fun to be around on the set, and thanks for getting me to direct. That was a great experience. I miss you. Best to Pam and the kids, and I hope to see you soon.
Okay.
Well, Baywatch is, in fact, the brainchild of a real lifeguard here in Los Angeles.
But, David, you were the man who came to the rescue when it really mattered.
One of its creators, executive producer, and still a lifeguard, Greg Bonin. Ah!
Unbelievable.
Hey, see this jacket? He got this from wardrobe.
Greg, tell us how David came to the rescue.
Well, actually, watching this from backstage has been really emotional, seeing what a part you played in so many people's lives. But David, 5 years ago, I had a dream, and it was to make a television show about lifeguards, which I'd been for a long time. And it had been a dream for a long time until David said yes. And together with my other partners, we took it to NBC, and they bought it, they aired it, and they canceled it. And I remember that was one of the saddest days of my life.
I remember the phone call.
And I called you up, and I said, David, would you consider standing by me for the next little while, which turned out to be 14 months, while we tried to resurrect it? And we did it, and it's in 70 countries. Recently said to be the most popular series in the history of television. And I can't tell you what a big part you played in my life, and thank you for standing by me.
Thank you for having me, brother. This is this is the real Baywatch. This is the real lifeguard. This is the man that invented the show, and this is the man who actually saved a boy's life while we were making Baywatch. So if we make a lot of money and we're in 73 countries, it doesn't matter. We save one boy's life, and it's because of him. Gregory Bonin.
Thank you.
Well, here are a couple more people who wouldn't be here without you. Your children, Taylor and Haley.
Yes, we met you. Taylor, Ian, come here, you. Wait, everybody, wait, everybody.
David Hasselhoff, this is your life.
Welcome back, and welcome back to our roving reporter, John Leslie, who, I have to say, has been seriously offered a part in Baywatch by David Hasselhoff.
Well, sort of.
What do you mean?
Well, we're chatting away, and he says, hey, you must come over. You must have a